So I as you saw in this video, and I don't know how many people blinked an eye, several of these are happening just as we talk about. And a lot of it is just happening in our own backyard. The significant amount of digital disruptions that have happened over the last few years are there for us to see. For instance, one of the significant things in Mr. Kant referred to the recreational space. Significant thing that happened to us was this Hotstar phenomenon by Star TV, which today has become one of the largest OTT players in the world. And just when the IPL final happened, apparently 200 million people watched that on Hotstar, right? And this is a nation where, you know, just even about 5 years ago, we would struggle to get internet bandwidth anywhere in the country. And these disruptions are happening around us. And with that context, if we jump on to what exactly is happening with the aircraft systems? And in this paper, what we have tried to do is provide a very practitioner view of the challenges that we have faced. Our firm, EY, works with a number of clients in bringing this technology to them. And at the end of the day, it is important to understand this in the overall context rather than just think of this as, you know, a device that just captures images and videos. The interesting thing about drone is the three things that we have put there. One, it reduces the cost of compliance. It definitely reduces the cost of using technology. And then there is the quality of information. To just give you an example, we were working with one of the leading solar plant agencies. And these projects are spread over 500, 600 acres. Now, these projects, I mean, the project that we worked on was almost a 12,000 crore project. And the biggest challenge that they face is getting accurate status. Now, for anybody to go and get the status manually for a 500, 600 acre project is going to take weeks, right? Now, we could get that report today using UAS. It takes about an hour to scan that entire area. And using a combination of the other disruptions that we spoke about, mainly around artificial intelligence, pattern recognition, machine learning, we were able to get to them what we call as a golden record, saying that, hey, this is exactly the status of your projects. This is where your panel installations are. This is where you know, the land has been excavated. And automatically, we were able to show to them, this is how your project is working against, the execution is working against your project plan. In fact, the conversations then shifted to a completely different level when the firm started having discussions with their own vendors. Several of these, they use different vendors to do this kind of projects. And the availability of the golden record made the discussions focus on the real status as opposed to conflicts over, you know, whether this is the right status. Because in the past, their meetings used to be completely dogged with you know what, the record that you've taken is 15 days old, 20 days old, we've made significant progress. And there is no way you could dispute that. But today with a golden record, with almost real-time monitoring, they are able to assess what is the status of their projects. At this point in time, I just want to reference an interesting thing that was mentioned in the parliament by the Ministry of Statistics and Planning. In 2017, November, out of a portfolio of 1,283 government infrastructure projects, which were value of 150 crores or above, close to about 1.75 lakh crores of projects were having project overruns. And the different government agencies were running helter-skelter to figure out what exactly is causing this. Is it land acquisition? Is it some other enforcement that is happening? Or what is the real status? And in fact, the government has established a project monitoring, what they call as a OCMS, project monitoring system, so that they can get a more accurate view of where are these things happening. And in fact, that is absolutely a no-brainer case study for something like a UAS to be put in there and get real status. As they say, knowing what the problem is or acknowledging that there is a problem is half the problem solved. The challenge where several infrastructure firms are struggling with is to define and understand the magnitude of the problem, because the actions there hence can be more effective. Again, I think Mr. Kant referred to quite a few of the uses. I would still say, as I'm sure everybody acknowledges, the scratching the surface applications of UAS in India. Predominantly, it is still heavily defense-based for obvious reasons. But then there have been snippets of firms trying to use this technology for addressing different use cases. But it is still extremely in its infancy. This again pertains to the point that I have been mentioning. A technology today in the digital world is not an isolated case. It has to be weaved in with the other disruptions that are happening today. So in a sense, in our experience of having worked with clients, you know, when we go and say that, look, this drone or this UAS will do this for you, it is sometimes absolutely a no-brainer. Yes, go ahead and scan the images and come back to me. But then what do you do with the rest of it? How do you use that for pattern recognition to make meaning, to make meaningful management decisions, or even looking at data in a meaningful manner? It requires not just usage of just UAS, but an ecosystem in which several of the other technologies can be brought into play. And the other thing is, there are naturally several use cases as articulated multiple times and above, but unless it is weaved into a comprehensive offering, we are going to see this just being a hobby, right? And instantly today, when we talk of, many people don't understand UAS unless in an industrial context, but when you say drone, what comes to people's mind is just, you know, the marriage drones or what you see in an IPL kind of a mode where the drones capture different recreational kind of emotions. But there is a significant use in industrial in the industrial world, but it requires a weaving in of all these other disruptions that are happening today. So again, when we were putting together this presentation, I think the market potential is something that I don't think any of us need to really debate about or argue, because depending on how you look at it, there is anywhere between, as Mr. Khan said, it could be a $50 billion industry for various uses of UAS. So the market potential, I don't think it's even a debate. In this paper, what we have attempted to do is give you a bit of a view of the market potential. We've also done a little bit of comparison of the regulations, at least with a couple of countries where the adoption has been significant. One is the US and the other is China, which kind of gives you a little bit of continuum between an extremely advanced country and a country that's maybe closer to India in terms of the challenges that it faces, and where there are good examples of you know, how the regulatory framework has helped in a massive adoption of drones. So we have created that. And the other thing is, how do we make that happen in India? The Kitty Hawk moment, right? In some sense, you know, if this convention was there 40 years down the line, and people would be talking as this seminar as maybe the Kitty Hawk moment. But how do we create that environment where this technology can be put to sensible use? So Mr. Kant covered the policy aspect in quite a bit of detail. The policy is definitely something that needs a hard look. It is sensitive technology, so imports are curbed, but then it offers a fertile market for Make in India, but it has to be enabled by policy. And there are several challenges in the policy which we have tried to articulate, including multiple windows to get your approvals. There is no single window for getting things done. Then how are the drones categorized? Is it in terms of their sizes? Do we have a one-shoe-fit-all kind of a model, or do we need to have specific policies depending on the type of drones? Then the other thing is even the line of sight or the altitude at which the drones will work. There again, there are limitations. Last but not the least, wherever we have worked with clients, we also had to, you know, because the regulations are in draft, when you go to several of these infrastructure projects and talk to them, you have to get the police permission, have detailed conversations with them because they just don't understand the technology. And it just makes adoption extremely hard. So hopefully, you know, as the policy gets drafted, and it does have to definitely address the obvious concerns of misuse of this technology, the policy intervention is right now the bottleneck in enabling this significantly. But we have two words of caution on this. Yes, the policy today is a bottleneck, but sometimes, you know, that is just the lull before the storm. Once the policy is drafted in whatever form and it somewhere gets into a mode where it can enable more UAS adoption, we are going to get hit with a supply-demand problem. There are not enough manufacturers today. There are not enough licensed pilots who can run this today. So for us to tap this market, once the regulations are drafted and it becomes clearer, the next part is, are we ready to really embrace it? So that is something that we need to be cognizant about. There is definitely a lot of manufacturers in India who are aiding defense. One, they need to be supported to really make maximum use of this demand-supply situation and thereby us becoming a leading power here. And lastly, for at the end of the day, this has to be adopted, and especially in this context, by corporates. And especially those who are in the different fields that were mentioned, let us say whether it's infrastructure projects, precision agriculture, companies like Gale, which want things to be monitored. It is important that it is not just about flying a drone and capturing images. It is probably monitoring as a service. It is probably security as a service. How do you kind of establish an ecosystem where, you know, the drones are an enabler for you to achieve your business objectives as opposed to it just being an isolated usage? So it needs to be tied up with the other disruptions. See, because at the end of the day, if you send out a drone, you capture images, but you are not able to relate it back to your project plan in a seamless manner, then what you've done is you've just kind of, your mess for less kind of situation. What I send guys into the field to do, I've captured it using drone, but if it still involves manual intervention significantly, you're going to lose the benefit of what it brings to the table. So it needs to be tied in with this entire ecosystem. And so when we work with our clients, we always talk to them as, don't look at it in isolation, but look at it as a service, as how does it help you satisfy your use cases. So with that context in mind, just a few steps as we've captured some of these things that today hamper us from a policy perspective, but at the same time, especially to the rest of the stakeholders who are firms that are into drone manufacturing, startups that are providing services for manufacturing, and also the corporates who are trying to use this technology, it is important to look upon this as a holistic offering and not just I remember talking to a client who said, look, at the end of the day, it's just a camera fitted to a helicopter, right? You could trivialize that to that extent, but on the other hand, this is a serious business opportunity that can not only enable Make in India, but can offer significant productivity improvements into the way that we are doing things today. So I think this is absolutely the Kitty Hawk moment, and it's up to this forum and beyond to understand this technology holistically and thereby make the most of it as we bring it forward to clients. Thank you so much for this opportunity, and I look forward to interacting with as many of you possible.